Amen. You can be seated. Thank you, Apostle Joshua. It is wonderful to be with you in wintertime in Florida. Feeling like wintertime. Look, we greet you in the name of the Lord. It is an honor to be back with you all. Let me just take a few minutes and kind of introduce ourselves, catch up on what God has been doing in our lives. Kim and I are coming up here in just a few months to 32 years married. She looks good for a 29, which is every year she turns 29. But Kim and I actually met in college in Springfield, Missouri, in a traveling music group. She sang, I played trumpet, we traveled around America and Canada together, and started dating. Now that I have a teenage daughter, I don't believe in dating. I believe in courtship. And I figure any young man who's ever interested in my daughter, I'm going to introduce him to every apostle and prophet on planet Earth that I know. And if he makes it through that gauntlet, he might have a chance. But anyway, Kim and I married there, graduated in 1986 and began traveling. So this year is 30 years. We've been traveling around the world in ministry. And God has blessed us so many ways. Through the years, we've gotten to go to every continent on earth declaring the word of the Lord except Antarctica. I'm not sure how many penguins need a prophecy. But we've had the privilege of traveling all over the world and ministering together. And it has been just wonderful, phenomenal. But for 17 years, it was just Kim and I. Doctors said it was medically impossible for us to have children. But how many of you know, as thankful as we are for doctors and medicine professionals, our faith is in the Word of the Lord. And Kim is a whole hour and a half long women's conference message that she does on the promise of Shekinah. But in 1989, the audible voice of the Lord came to my wife. In a spirit-filled Baptist church, any Baptist-costals? In a spirit-filled Baptist church, it spoke and said, I will make you a Hannah. And then a year later, she had a visitation from the Lord. And in this visitation in 1990, the Lord showed her a young woman ministering. It was a mass crowd, like a Reinhard Bonnke-type crusade. And the dead were being raised. Arms were growing out. Legs were growing out. Eyeballs growing in. And in this experience, the Lord said, this is your daughter. And he said, you have no choice on her name. Her name is Shekinah, for the glory of God will be upon her. And so for years, Kim declared around the world, we're going to have a little girl. You all and several others had prophesied and declared, come into agreement and declaration that God is going to bring our Shekinah. So in early 2001, I was in Karachi, Pakistan, helping to train church planters to reach out to the Muslim peoples. How many of you know Jesus died for Muslims? And Kim was not with me on that particular trip. And I got a phone call at 5:30 in the morning in Karachi, Pakistan. And Kim, it was on the other end, and she said, are you sitting down? That's not necessarily how you want to start that kind of a phone call. She had a checkup at a doctor, just a checkup. And she said, Shekinah is on the way. We had never been pregnant before and lost a child. She just could not get pregnant. But God had honored. And so Shekinah is now 14 years old. Ben, let me see, how many airplanes is it now?
379 and still counting.
So she's keeping track, been all across Europe, Australia, the U.S., and Canada with us ministering. And it was exciting to see as God has been ministering in and through her life. At 2 years old, she accepted Jesus. At 3 years old, baptized in the Holy Spirit. At 5 years old, started laying hands on the sick with us to sing Jesus heal them. At 7 years old, began to prophesy. And so, you know, as the apostle said about these children that just walked out, they're not the church of the future, they're the church of today. And so it has been just wonderful and awesome watching as Shekinah has grown in the things of the Lord. Took 7 years of ballet. What else was it you did? Dance-wise?
7 years of ballet, 1 year of tap, 1 year of acrobatic, 1 year of gymnastics, 1 year of hip-hop, and 1 year of jazz.
And now she wants to be a Broadway actress, so we'll see where God takes all that. Anyway, it has been just a wonderful time, and we're excited to be with you all. We've been down in Florida for about a week. We base in Hampton, Virginia, and from there travel out to the nations. In fact, just this last couple of days, we spent a couple of days with the apostle that we worked with for years in Virginia, a guy named Ron Johnson, a mutual friend of ours. And he sends greetings. They said to tell you because they love you. And they just so admire what God's doing in your life and how you've pressed forward for the Lord and everything and made declaration for the kingdom of God. So we send their greetings as well. But we're so excited what God has in store for us today. After we with you today, we head out tomorrow and hang a few days in Daytona Beach and then back to Kissimmee where we get to go to Disney and all that good stuff and minister around the area for a few weeks. And but later on this year, we're heading to Europe. God has opened doors in a lot of different places, but we're going to be a church in London that we've been going to since 1993. And the first time we were there, tell them just quickly about that Sunday morning service. The first time we were there in 1993, church about 150 people, storefront church, and the place was packed, not because of us, but people were hungry for God. And that morning, God did something very unique.
Yeah, I had never seen this part before at first, is we had seen miracles during the week. And all of a sudden, all these visitors showed up because they were curious. A lot of them really didn't know anything about God. They were curious. They wanted to find out, what is this? Why are all these people getting healed? And so that morning, on Sunday morning, there were so many visitors that had come to the church that the pastor stood on the platform and said this: all of the people that regularly attend this church, go and stand in the foyer. We will leave the doors open, and the visitors come in and take all the seats. That's a pretty good problem to have. So we had a whole sanctuary full of visitors that didn't really even know anything about God. And the foyer was full of the God-fearing, worshiping people. And so that's what was happening. In fact, the ushers had given away our chairs. We didn't even have a chair to sit in. We had to stand the whole time. And so, I didn't mind, but I thought, boy, I have not seen this before. And so we were standing worshiping. Now, you know, of course, these people that had no idea about God, they didn't know what was going on. But a lot of them put their hands up in the air, too, because that's what you're supposed to do, I guess. So they had their hands up in the air, and we're singing praise to God. And something happened. A holy hush fell on these people that had no idea about God. All of a sudden, we were just jubilantly worshiping God, and nobody led this to do it. All of a sudden, and everything was total silence in the building. And I found my knees were knocking, and we were all shaking. I mean, literally shaking. You couldn't stop it. You were just literally shaking from head to toe. And then I started hearing a sound. My eyes were closed during this. And then I heard a sound. I'm thinking, what is going on? And I opened up my eyes. And the wind, the actual Holy Spirit wind, had blown in the building as a wind. And he was coming up like a little tornado down the center aisle of the church. And all of a sudden, as the Holy Spirit, as an actual wind, passed the rows very slowly, going very slowly up the aisle, the whole row would go down. Bam! 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 All the visitors are on the floor. Hardwood chairs, hardwood floor. They were hitting hard. Nobody was hurt. I mean, there was no catchers. And they were all down on the floor. And they all got radically saved. Now, that same church, that was 150 people at that time, that same church, all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost absolutely did an amazing explosion in this church. It now runs 1,500. And have people from 78 nations there. In fact, one of the heathen guys that was there that morning, and he got blown away by the wind, he is now the missions pastor of this church. I love how God works.
And so this church, we're going to be living there for about 2 months. And we're working at that church and another large church that's actually, interestingly, a seeker-sensitive church that 2 years ago came to us and said, we need the supernatural. And so we're going to be working with them, training and teaching them and moving in the supernatural, stepping out in faith. And so just wonderful. But we've had a chance to get to know Joshua through the years. I think first met at a Bill Hammond conference years ago up in the Panhandle. Got to be with you all in the early 2000s. And then I had the privilege of being part of 555. And in fact, some of those apostles I met, John Polis specifically, good friend of ours. And through him, we're ministering in Croatia a lot. So while we're in Europe, we're going to base in England, but minister across Europe. And God's doing so many things. I'm not going to tell you a lot of other stories right now before we get to the Word. But at the end of May last year, as we were in Europe, God opened the doors to Israel. And back when we were 19 years old, God spoke and said, the day is going to come when God's going to release again his apostles and prophets to declare the word of the Lord in Jerusalem and in Israel. And the Lord spoke in our hearts and said, we would get to be among them, not the big cheese, but among them. Well, through a divine circumstance, God opened the door, and we were at the prayer center that overlooks the Dome of the Rock and the Mount Zion and Mount of Olives, and staying there for 10 days declaring the word of the Lord. And so a lot of wonderful things that God is doing. But how many of you know America needs an awakening? And we believe the prophetic word of the Lord has got to be released, not just to individuals to bring encouragement, but into the spirit realm, into the atmosphere, to do what Apostle said, to bring breakthrough and all these things. So we're excited to partner with you all and all that God has. So, Kim, is there anything else in particular you want to share right now?
Yeah, I was going to share. He was talking about our nation. Have you guys had a burden for our nation lately? I mean, you've seen everything that's going on. My goodness. But I tell you what, the Lord is doing a work there. In fact, you know, I can't go into the whole testimony of Shekinah. I speak at all kinds of conferences and speak for an hour and a half. And Russ would have my head if I did that. So I won't do that. But it was interesting. A lady there, part of the testimony, there was a Nigerian woman in London, England. She didn't know anything about us. We'd never met her before. And she walked up to me at the end of a service. She had no idea we were even believing for children or wanted children. She didn't know anything like that. By the way, it was a medical impossibility. I was born with a genetic defect that made it medically impossible to have a child. And so this lady comes up. And she is this older lady. She's very Nigerian. And she puts her little finger right on the tip of my nose. And she says, God has spoken to me. I must do a 40-day fast for you. Your body will work correctly. And you will have a child. That's what she... And I'm looking at her. And she didn't know anything about me. And I'm looking and she's little. She's tiny little thing. She's older. And I'm thinking, she can't go 40 days without eating. It'll kill her. I thought, I got to talk her out of this. And so my brain's going like this. And so I finally looked at her and said, you know, sister, maybe you can fast lunch for me and Russ every day. And she goes, no, God has spoken. It's okay. And I ran away from her. She was scary. And this lady, I didn't even know, a Nigerian woman in London, did 40 days water only. Can you imagine doing this for somebody you don't even know? 40 days water only. Can't go into it all, but 3 days after she finished that fast, all of a sudden things started clicking in my body that had never worked before. And it was still a while before we had the baby, but she was a big component of that miracle. And so, this woman, we found out, has a huge track record of prophetic accuracy that blows your mind. We didn't know who she was, but this is who she is. And she called us many years ago, actually several years ago, and she said, I just had an encounter with the Lord, and he showed me the three of you, Russ, Kim, and Shekinah, getting an invitation to the White House to share the word of the Lord with the president. Now, with other people, you know, we kind of just put it on a shelf, like, yeah, okay. But with this woman, she's got a track record. And yet you don't know how it's going to happen. That just seems like pie in the sky stuff. I mean, the president? I mean, how would that work? And yet, something happened in August that kind of set things in motion, and we're just kind of wondering if it's going to come into play. First of all, it starts off. In Florida, we were doing a revival back several years ago in Venice, Florida. We were exhausted. We got caught in a Tennessee ice storm on the drive to Florida. And we were stuck on the interstate, had to turn off the engine. We barely made it in time for the Sunday morning service. We were so exhausted. And I mean, our hair was sticking up. We looked horrible. And we went in, and me and Russ looked at each other and said, you know what? Let's make this the shortest service we have ever done. And so we will go and take a nap at the hotel all afternoon. We won't even eat. And then we will give them our all tonight. You know how that's how your human brain works. And so we walk in, they put on my soundtrack to sing, and I stand up there like a total goofball. I can't remember the words. Like, and my music's playing, and I don't remember any words. Russ gets up there to preach, and it's the worst sermon he has ever done in his whole life. He doesn't make a lick of sense. I'm thinking, what are you even talking about? I'm thinking, give it up, Russ. And then he just kind of throws out there pitifully at the end, if anybody wants Jesus as Savior, come to the front. And the whole church runs up to the front. And I'm thinking, why? And you know, God taught me a real big lesson that morning. It's not about us. It's not if I could sing good or he could preach good. It's not about us at all. It's about God. And they ran to the front sobbing, and the Holy Spirit fell on the place. And then we just went melted right into the second service because everybody was out on the floor. The pastor said God dropped a bomb on the church. So we were there for 4 months in revival in Venice, Florida. And it was an awesome, awesome time. But one of the families that got radically touched became our very good friends. And this family was just bound up in fear. They had 7 kids, I think. And so they had a lot of kids. The mother, Kelly, my age, she just didn't even want to leave the house. She was so fearful. She was just so afraid. She wouldn't ever even think of getting on an airplane. God radically touched this family. They were all out on the floor many, many nights. And God touched them, called all of them in the ministry, including the kids and the parents. And God has taken them now so many places. But one of the places God has taken these people is to Redding, California. I don't know if you've heard. There is a church there called Bethel. And so took them there. The entire family went through Bible college together, parents and children. You don't see that often. After they had been radically touched in the revival in Venice, Florida. And now God has set them on fire. They have been all over the world seeing God do amazing things. But the church there just appointed them in, I believe, the end of July to go to Washington, D.C. The church there, actually, there was a girl that went out to the school in Bethel. And she had gotten, now this is a girl I don't even know. She got radically touched by God. She came back home and her multi-millionaire grandmother saw such a huge difference in this girl. She goes, what happened to you out there? What has happened to you? You are a different girl. And the girl told her all about what God had done in her life. And the grandmother says, I want to do something for this church. And she owns a mansion on Embassy Row in Washington, D.C. She has given the church use of this mansion right with all the embassies. It's all there, right there. In fact, the backyard backs up to the vice president's house. And so they have been given this. So they were moving in, and we happened to be in Washington, D.C. You know how God just happens to do stuff in your life? And that's what happened there. So we are there, and we get together with our friends as they're unpacking and doing all the stuff in this mansion. They are going to be the host of this house because they had to have a host. They were sent forth as the host of this house where they can bring in the dead of night like Nicodemus. They can bring in senators or whoever and give the word of the Lord in the middle of the night. So that's what this house is for. And so we were there and visiting with our friends, and I couldn't figure it out. I was a little irritated. You know how you get irritated with God at times when he doesn't do what you think he's supposed to do? And so what had happened was almost all of our bookings for August just kind of went out the window, and they all canceled. I'm thinking, that's not right. What is wrong with those guys? Why are they doing this? And I was mad, everything else. So now we had the whole month of August free. So we end up there. And we were visiting with our friends, and it ended up that they started going to Embassy Church there on Embassy Road. And the pastor there felt a heart connection with our friends that had got radically moved on and saved and called the ministry in Florida. He said, I feel such a heart connection to you, and I feel I need to have a speaker in. You see, I had a senator that was supposed to speak Sunday morning, and he's backed out on me. And he goes, but I know I'm not supposed to be preaching. I'm supposed to have a visitor that day come preach. Do you know anybody that might want to come in and minister? This is Washington, D.C., Embassy Church, Embassy Row. And so we ended up going in there and ministering, and the Holy Spirit fell on Embassy Row and Embassy Church. God had his way in such a big thing. In fact, the pastor stood there scratching his head, and he says, Russ Klein, I know that name. And he pulled out his old phone, and there was an elder in his church that had come to a conference. We had a very big church in Hampton, Virginia, that we were part of the apostolic team, and runs about 3,000 people. And we had lots of conferences. And he said, my head elder went to a conference at that church in Hampton, Virginia, and heard a young man speaking named Russ Klein, came back and said, I was radically touched by God through this young man named Russ Klein, a prophet of God. We need to have him in here. This will change our church. God is going to use that man in our church. Well, the pastor had put down all the stuff in the phone, but never did anything with it. Now that elder has died, just like real soon, right before we got there. And the pastor pulls out his phone, and he still has Russ's information in the phone. Is that not amazing? And we ended up ministering the whole month of August, basically, in Washington, D.C., prophesying over ambassadors and doing things that were just beyond. And you dream with me for a minute. Do you remember the prophecy that the lady gave us from Nigeria? She said that we three would have an invitation to the White House to give the word of the Lord. Does it not seem like God could use this? We ministered there, saw the Holy Spirit fall. In fact, I watched my daughter and Lizzie, their little girl, the family there, that's about 2 years older than Shekinah. The two teenage girls went around and they were prophesying over all these bigwigs, prophesying over everybody in the church, saw the Holy Spirit fall. Incredible stuff. Incredible stuff. But dream with me. Could it not be possible, as we are ministering and prophesying to an ambassador or some government leader that comes into Embassy Church and goes back and word of mouth goes and it reaches the president's ears and says, I must have that family. I need to hear the word of the Lord. Dream with me. Is God not big enough to do that? It seems a whole bunch more possible right now. And God had his way. I was irritated because all of our services in August canceled. But God had his way ministering there in our nation's capital. And we're believing for our capital to just explode with the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, Kim. I appreciate it. Here's the thing. Kim said this a few moments ago. And it goes back to a song we sang during worship. She said, it's not about the gifted person. It's not about the vessel. It's about Jesus. It's not about how great we can preach. And let me just tell you this from the get-go. I will not try to preach like Apostle. He's a preaching machine. I can't even keep up. And that's awesome. But see, thank God for the giftings and all these other things. But it's Jesus. And in the simplicity of how we present him. And we sang a song that said, Jesus be the center. I want to read you a scripture from Ephesians chapter 1. Now, Ephesians was a church much like Antioch and Jerusalem. It was an apostolic church. It was an apostolic center. Now, you all are an apostolic church, an apostolic people. You understand some of the kingdom terminologies and concepts. But we understand this. Not every local expression of the body of Christ has the same mandate. Every individual person has a different call, a different ministry, a different mandate. We are all called to be full of Christ, but we're all going to express Christ differently within the context of our personality and our sphere of influence. And I believe that holds true even in the local church. I don't believe every local church is going to have apostles and prophets leading the church, though they need to have the influence and voice of the apostles and prophets there. But there are places that God has birthed to be apostolic centers and places of influence. And Ephesus was a city and a church like that. And Paul, the father, the apostolic father of this church, had a prayer. He prayed. And I believe this is an apostolic prayer for an apostolic people. So this is Ephesians chapter 1, and I only read it out of the Message paraphrase. And so Paul says this, verse 5 of chapter 1. That's why when I heard of the solid trust you have in the Master Jesus, and your outpouring of love to all the followers of Jesus, I couldn't stop thanking God for you. Every time I pray, I think of you and give thanks. But I do more than thank God. I ask Him. I ask the God of our Master, Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent and discerning. Boy, you could really unpack that. Can you imagine a church full of people that have a brain? And discernment. That we don't have to be weak-minded to prove that we're Spirit-filled. That we can have excellence in everything that we do, and yet discernment of the Spirit. But anyway, that's another message I won't go into. To make you intelligent and discerning in knowing Him personally. Your eyes focused and clear. Back several years ago, Kim had a vision. We've heard it through many different places. But she saw a giant who was asleep, and the giant began to awake, began to wipe its sleep out of its eyes and began to rouse. And we understand the church has been a giant who's asleep, but is arising again. Wiping the sleep out of our eyes so we can see focused and clear. So that you can see exactly what it is He is calling you to do. See, one of the things that I'm finding, I'm 52 years old, been preaching since I was 15 years old. And I know this, I can do a lot of stuff, but what is it God has called me to do? I think sometimes we waste our time, we waste our energy, and we waste our resources doing good things and not God things. And so we've got to find, and that's part of what this intelligence and discernment that comes from apostolic anointing does, helps us to see exactly what God's called us to do, to grasp the immensity of this glorious way of life He has for His followers. Oh, the utter extravagance of His work in us who trust Him. Endless energy and boundless strength. How many of you take vitamins? How many of you drink energy drinks? Why? For endless energy and boundless strength. Can I tell you the key to endless energy and boundless strength is not just your exercise routine. It's not just doing without gluten in your diet. It is not just your energy drinks. It is knowing exactly what God's called you to do. Because in that place, there is abounding energy and strength to accomplish what God has called us to do. That's the prayer of the apostle for his people. Verse 20, all this energy issues from Christ. God raised Him from death and set Him on a throne in deep heaven in charge of running the universe. Everything from galaxies to governments. No name and no power exempt from His rule. And not just for the time being, but forever. He is in charge of it all. Has the final word on everything. I don't know if you've heard this little play on the word history, but the idea is this. History is His story. He is to be the center point of history, including the history of your life. Let's go on and see what it says. It says, at the center of all this, going back to what Kim said, it's all about Jesus. The song we sang, be the center of it all. At the center of all of this, Christ rules the church. When Joshua was about to take the people of Israel into the promised land, Joshua chapter 5, remember this, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joshua. And Joshua went to the angel and said, whose side are you on? Here's what amazes me. When God shows up, when the prophetic anointing of God is there, when the voice of the Lord is there, people want to know whose side God's on. Whose opinion do you agree with? What kind of music do you like? How long of a service do you like? What kind of preaching do you like? I have found this. We will argue over the most inane, stupid things and try to get prophetic revelation to back us up. How many of you have ever heard somebody prophesy and it's what everybody wants to hear, but it's not the word of the Lord? And you see, that's the thing is, people, even leaders, will go and say, whose side are you on? And what did the angel say? He said, I'm not here on anyone's side. I'm here to command God's army. Good friend of mine who leads the house of prayer in Jerusalem, he puts it this way. When God comes to church, He doesn't come to take sides. He comes to take over. Christ rules the church. And catch this, the verse 22 and 23 in Ephesians 1. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. Now, catch that mentality. The mentality most of us have in the American church is that we have big, bad society out there, and we are the persecuted little church trying to get somebody to listen to our voice. But the biblical concept of the kingdom of God, Jesus being exemplified and exhibited through the church, is that we are the centerpiece of society, Jesus being the center of the church. That means we are not yelling and trying to get the world's attention. That means, as the apostle said, we don't have to cater to people's immaturity. We don't have to cater to their desire to have an easy believism. We are not trying to cater to them. We're catering to the presence of God, and He will draw all men to Himself. So it says the church is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body, in which He speaks and acts, by which He fills everything with His presence. So, the church is to be the centerpiece of society to do what? To bring the manifestation of the kingdom of God. And we know when it's talking about John the Baptist and Elijah, who He comes in the spirit and the power of, have always been some of my favorite characters in Scripture. From the time I was 9 years old, got baptized in the Holy Spirit and called into prophetic ministry, 9 years old. I love the story of Elijah. And that idea of God raising up men and women that will confront the powers of hell at the highest places and believe God for outward demonstration. See, Elijah prayed, God, let there be, God answered by fire so that people will know You are God. The way I prayed is this, God, let there be a visible physical manifestation of Your glory that people know You are the one true God. I don't know about you, I'm tired of walking into churches where the preacher gets up and says, oh, don't you feel the presence of God? And I want to stand up and yell, no, I don't. There's got to be a reality beyond whether you want to call it Pentecostal, whether you want to call it Spirit, whatever, that what we've done in deceiving ourselves into believing the presence of God is there because our emotions get moved. Some of our friends, before they accepted the Lord, they had been hypnotists. Now, not stage hypnotists, but, hypnotists to help them, lose weight and quit smoking, all that. Of course, they both are overweight. But anyway, they came to the Lord. And here was interesting. They came into the Spirit-filled movement. And they said this, do you know that most Spirit-filled services use hypnotic technique? Now, they were not being accusatory against preachers, but they're saying many preachers, without even realizing what they're using and doing, use hypnotic technique, whether it's by repeating the same phrase over and over, or using mood and music and everything else. Look, there's nothing wrong with declaration and repeating the word of the Lord and all these other things, but we've got to be careful that we don't move from the spirit to the soulish realm. And I've been in many Pentecostal meetings that have great excitement, but it's soulish. That's not going to convince a world that's lost of the reality of Jesus Christ. It's going to take a manifestation, outward, manifestation of the glory of God. So Elijah prayed, God, let there be a manifestation of Your glory. Why? So that the nation would turn back to God. So they would know that there is a true God. John the Baptist came in the spirit and the power of Elijah. And Jesus, speaking about John the Baptist, talks about a lot of different things. One of my spiritual sons in the prophetic was reading one time when Jesus was speaking about John the Baptist. And he said to the people, what did you go to see? Who did you go to hear? A prophet? He said, yes, but I tell you, more than a prophet. And this young man, he began to ask the Lord. He said, God, what does that mean, more than a prophet? Here's what he felt the Lord say. Prophets announce what is coming, but more than a prophet brings Jesus right onto the scene. See, a prophet declares Jesus is coming more than a prophet says, and here He is. See, God's called us to be more than just the Old Testament manifestation of a prophetic people declaring what God's going to do. We need to bring Jesus and be Jesus. If you want to use a modern term, incarnate Jesus into our spheres of influence. And it said about this this manifestation of God through John, the kingdom of God. Jesus said, the kingdom, the government of God is under attack. It suffers violence. And we see that around us. One of my personal feelings is that terrorism that we see in the natural is just a manifestation. One part of it is a manifestation of the spirit of the enemy, who is a terrorist, trying to bring intimidation to the body of Christ. But it says that God is raising up forceful men and women who will take the kingdom. Violent people that will take the kingdom by force. And we understand our enemy is not the terrorists. Our enemy is not the abortionists. Our enemy are the powers of hell. And we've got to learn how to fight in the spirit again. Look, I remember the 1980s and everything was spiritual warfare. We went around calling the devil names and screaming at the devil. And, you know, we'd stomp and do all those things. And I love that. I agree with all of that. But I came to a place of saying, how many times are we going to go call the devil names without getting any breakthrough? I've been in the places where we repent of every sin we can think of. And where we live in Hampton, Virginia, we have African American, we have American Indian or Native American, and you know, us European Americans. And man, we have had every kind of repentance you can think of. And we've gone to the grounds where the first slaves are brought. We've gone to the grounds where the first slaughter of Native Americans happened, all 15 minutes from our house. We've repented of everything you think of. We've rung bells, banged drums. Every prophet and apostle comes through our area because we're the entrance to it all. And yet nothing has changed. Can we be realistic enough to say how many more drums we got to bang and bells we got to ring? How many more times I have to say, I'm sorry already? Please hear what I'm saying. I'm not against those things, but there comes a time for a wake-up call. And that is, we've got to go beyond all the outward things and begin to engage the enemy, not just in our little church services, but daily as we go forward. And it says the violent people will take the kingdom by force. I work with a ministry. I was a street preacher from the time I was 15 years old. So Mardi Gras, Indy 500, New York, Chicago, L.A., all that other stuff. And, you know, carrying a 10-foot cross and preaching on the streets and those things. But one of the groups I worked with, their ministry is called Christ in Action. Great street ministry. Christ in Action, but they called themselves the CIA. You know, Christ in Action. And they had a T-shirt that demonstrated this militant attitude. They had a sheep on this T-shirt, a sheep, a lamb, standing on 2 feet like sheep always do. I don't know. There we go. Had on military gear, had on a bandana, and the caption said, Lambo. A righteous Rambo. There comes a time that we have got to come out of our wimpy, self-focused, crybaby Christianity. Look, I love pastors. We need pastors. But I thank God I'm not a pastor because they have to put up with people. Let me ask, how many of you have ever been hurt by somebody in your life? Okay, I have a word for you. Get healed and get a life. Everybody's been hurt. Get healed. God wants to heal you. But your pain is not your identity. Our apostolic leader says it this way. Your identity is not your history, it's your destiny. Who you are is not based on your past. It's based on your future and where God's taking you. So get healed, but then move on. Don't be one of those people that you come in that door and everybody runs out that door because they know you're going to talk about your pain and your problem for 10 years, 20 years. Let's lay aside the past and become warriors for the Lord. John the Baptist, he talked about the kingdom. And I love the way he says it in Matthew chapter 3, verse 2. In the King James, it says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I don't want to unpack that just a second. The G. Campbell Morgan translation of that scripture puts it this way. Change your attitudes and actions, for an invasion of the Spirit is imminent. See, Kim's fourth generation is Pentecostal. You're fifth generation. I've been around it since I was 9 years old. I know how to repent in Pentecostal style. It's a bunch of snot rags around the front, right? And that proves you've changed. But see, I know how to cry with the best of you and not change. Kim and Shekinah can put on a chick flick. You know what a chick flick is, right? 55 minutes of something sad, and at the end, finally, something good happens. That's my definition of a chick flick. And I do the man thing. I don't want to watch that. 5 minutes later, I'm sitting there crying. Look, I can cry. You get somebody that can preach like an apostle and some of the people he hangs with. Man, I mean, it will touch your spirit, but it challenges and even moves your emotions, which is a good thing, not a bad thing. But I know how to cry without changing. Repentance is not about how you act. It's not about your emotions. It's making a decision to change the way you think and talk and act. Why? For an invasion of the Spirit. The kingdom of God is the invasion of the Spirit of God into every fiber of society. But you and I know God has already given His Son. He's given His Spirit. He's given His Word. What else are we waiting for? Sometimes we pray, God, send revival. And God's saying, already sent it. What are you doing with it? I believe in seasons of God. Please don't misunderstand that. But God, I think Charles Finney, great revivalist, said, God is a pent-up revival. And He's inside of you and I, waiting for us to bring revival forward for the things of the kingdom of God. But there's an invasion of the Spirit coming, but it's got to happen through change. And here's what I want to focus on as we come to a close of this sharing. As I believe the repentance doesn't start at the White House. The repentance doesn't start at the Supreme Court. The repentance starts at my house. I believe in the kingdom of righteousness, peace, and joy. But how many times have we declared and decreed the kingdom of out there when righteousness, peace, and joy is not ruling and reigning in our own lives? I'm not saying we have to be perfect. Okay, there's grace. But guys, when we don't exercise kingdom authority in the very sphere in which we have the most authority, how are we expected to happen out there? The kingdom of God, Luke says, is in us. So we need to see that authority, the kingdom of God, work out in every day of our lives. And then we can begin to move in that kind of authority. Here's what I found. God's giftings come, Romans says, without repentance. God uses donkeys. Remember that in Scripture? God spoke to a donkey. So here's my contention. If God speaks to you, it's because you're the closest donkey around. It's not a stamp of approval on your lifestyle. It's not a stamp of approval on your doctrine. You're the donkey. But more than anointing, we want authority. And authority is not earned, but God has to see, can He trust you with authority? And how can He trust us with authority if we don't have His heart? See, one of the cries of our heart is, God, break us. In fact, every time we minister, God, give us your heart of love. Look, we've been doing this long enough. We can stand here and operate our gift and do our stuff. But we pray, God, on our way coming here, God, give us your heart that somehow we feel the heartbeat of heaven for these individuals here today. And it's that kind of thing that releases when Jesus released a miracle power on the crowds and said He looked in the crowds and had compassion on them. And so the compassion of the Lord, the heart of the Lord, is the key to releasing the authority of God and the kingdom of God. But we're going to see the government of God operate through normal people. How many of you are somewhat normal? God is bringing forth a naturally supernatural people. That means we don't have to be what I call granola Christians. Nuts, flakes, and fruits. Kim and I have been around the prophetic since 1987, and we've seen our share of nuts, flakes, and fruits. Here's my belief. You can disagree if you want. God will use weird people. But the anointing doesn't make them weird. They're already weird. God's, hear this. When I was a young preacher, and please don't take offense if I mention a preacher that you like. When I was a young preacher, I didn't know who I was. So growing up in an African-American area where I was in Virginia, I tried to be black for a while. you know. And, you know, Joshua has the swag. I didn't have it, you know. But I would scream for an hour and a half, and I had an afro. When Kim and I first started dating, her parents said I walked like George Jefferson. You remember George Jefferson? I worked in a GQ black men's clothing store in Hampton, Virginia called Gents. And so, yo, we're going to hook you up with today. And I could walk and talk it. But it wasn't me. So I tried to be Benny Hinn. And I had an almost white suit. My hair wasn't quite crooked, but, you know, it was, and I blew on people all the time. And they fell. Now I have Tic Tacs to make sure it doesn't happen unless it's God. But, then I tried to be Dwight Thompson. And I had a TV preacher. And I had a perm, but it was brushed out. And I had hair down to here. And it was like a big lion's mane. And it wasn't about Howard's style. I was trying to capture somebody's anointing. And I thought it was in the style. I thought it was in the presentation. And I realized, just be Russ. Just be who you are. God has anointed and called you and given you your sphere of influence and giving you authority in that place. So what is repentance? What is change? Some of it is change your pale imitation of somebody else and be who you are. Be an original. I think it was Winston Churchill said, when the eagles are silent, the parrots begin to jabber. When the people of vision are silent, all you hear is somebody parroting what somebody else has said. Somebody else's revelation. God has something unique for you. We need to change the way we do church in 21st century America. One of the biggest ways, and again, you can talk about all things. Yes, every sin that's out in the world, unfortunately, is in the church. And we need to repent of those things. But look, I'm not just going to give you a laundry list of all of that stuff. I want to say we need to repent for being an audience and not an army. You will not find the New Testament church painted as an audience watching a performer strut his stuff. There comes a time that we've got to bring our leaders, not put them under our feet, but bring them off of the pedestal. The guy that was one of our mentors in the prophetic was a prophet named Augustine. And a powerful man of God. He was the founding prophet of the IHOP, Mike Bickle, all that group. And Augustine would say this. He'd say to people, I'm not an angel or an alien. And he'd say, do not put me on a pedestal because God will share his glory with no one. And then he said something that had never crossed my mind. He said, even if I don't want the glory, but you keep giving me the glory, God will have to remove me because his glory is still being shared. Do you know you're doing a disservice to the men and women of God when you idolize them? We honor, but it doesn't mean we idolize. We've got to stop being an audience and start arising. That means you don't, I love services like what you talked about. It was last Sunday where the ladies, or whoever it was, they were prophesying and hit every individual. Kim and Ashkana and I do that sometimes. But can I tell you, I don't know about you, I've got so many prophecies, it would take me 5 lifetimes to fulfill them all. Sometimes what I need is not another prophecy. What I need is a kick in the pants. Or a word of wisdom of how to apply that prophetic revelation. So guys, we must see the invasion of the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of God, the government of God, what God put in my heart for this year, for this season, is Isaiah 9. And I close with this. It said, and it hit me during the Christmas season because we hear the scripture over and over in the Christmas season. For unto you a child is born, unto you a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulder. And it goes on about the ever-increasing government of God. And the Lord spoke in my heart and said, it's going to be a fresh season of focus on the young generation and them arising. A child is born. Number two, a son is given. We're seeing a fresh revelation of fathering and sonship. And that's not fathers that demand that you carry their briefcase and pay them money to be your spiritual father. I got so fed up with that a few years ago in the apostolic movement, and it hit me. I have a daughter. My daughter doesn't pay me one red cent to be her dad. She gives me gifts because she loves me, but she doesn't pay me to be her dad. I lay down my life for her. You may have spiritual fathers, need spiritual fathers, but that doesn't mean we pay them to be our father. They lay down our lives. You see, Paul said about apostles, we are the off-scouring of all things, the filth of the world. Teach that at an apostolic conference and see how many apostles want to be called. Look, our job in apostle, prophet, foundational ministry, you walk into a building. When you see the building, you don't see the foundation. You know what the foundation is? It's in the dirt. We don't take apostles and put them under our feet and walk on them. Apostles lower themselves. Prophets lower themselves. And we put our face in the dirt so you, the body of Christ, will climb on our back and go higher than we ever will. You'll cast out more devils, prophesy to more people, lead more people to Jesus than we ever will. If we're doing our job and coming off the pedestal and getting under and being a foundation for the church of Jesus Christ. The government of God goes forward. Jesus being the center of the church being the center piece of society. I was with an Australian apostle a couple months ago, and he was talking about, he lives here in America, and he was talking about the division even in the believing community when it comes to government and politics. Now, I'm not here to advance my politics, okay? I'm a 52-year-old white male. Guess what my politics are? But here's what I found. The government of God and the kingdom of God is bigger than my opinion. And it's bigger than your opinion. Here's what he said. He said he was in a meeting, multiracial meeting, and they were talking about politics and really got into it. And, you know, believers, and they were going at one another and everything else. He said, okay, let's look at Scripture. He said, Jesus talks about the day is coming when sheep nations and goat nations are going to be divided, right? What's the one criteria in the Bible that separates sheep nations and goat nations? Remember? How they treat the poor. One biblical criteria. It is not their social the morals of the nation. I believe in morals. I believe in godliness. Don't misunderstand me. I'm talking about biblical, not taking our desires and reading into it, but taking one biblical criteria. How did you treat the poor? Did you visit them in prison? Did you clothe them when they were naked? Did you feed them when they were hungry? What kind of government does that sound like? Come on, say it. Sounds socialistic almost. Uh-oh. We're messing with things now. Then he said, Jesus also taught the principles of the government of God, or called the kingdom of God. And one of those stories was about three men that were given money. They were given talents. So they were given money and told, get a job. Do something with it. So you know what the poor man did? He stuck the money in the ground. Had no entrepreneurial initiative. Didn't want to work. Just wanted a handout. You know what the other two did? They put the money to work. And they started getting wealthy. Fact, when the owner came back, he took the money away from the poor man and gave it to the richest man. Sounds like capitalism. So which is it? Or are we fighting the wrong battle? I love America. We travel all over the world. I love America. I've got my ideas and my understandings. But the government of God is bigger than getting my man or woman in the White House. Somewhere in the midst of fighting for awakening in America, don't forget, this is bigger than any one geopolitical nation. It's bigger than a political party. That means you and I have got to be people that see with eyes of eternity. And how do we see? Through the Word and the Spirit. We've got to know the Word of God. The foundation for every revelation, every experience. But we also have to have open eyes. Revelation chapter 4, John the Revelator said, I saw a door standing open in heaven, and I heard a voice saying, come up here. I believe we're about to see a release of a prophetic dimension that has not been released by and large in America. And that is beyond words of knowledge. I love words of knowledge. I love when God does that. It's Kim, especially, more than me. She's a seer. God will give her people's names sometimes and details of life. I love when God does that. But what God's doing is going to be bigger and be able to tell somebody their name, their address, their birthdays, and all those other things, as awesome as that is. What God's going to do is bring a prophetic revelation that's more than being able to tell you your destiny 5 years from now, 2 days from now, and 30 years from now. God's bringing a revelation of what the kingdom of heaven looks like so we can see it established on earth. And let me bring it back to where we began. I believe what's going to make heaven heaven is not going to be streets of gold. Not going to be mansions. It's not going to be the lack of tears and the lack of sickness. Here's what I believe. You could be in a place with streets of gold, mansions fair, no tears and no sickness. If Jesus weren't there, you'd be in hell. Heaven and the kingdom of heaven is not about meat and drink. But it's His presence, righteousness, peace, and joy. That is the kingdom we want to see demonstrated and manifest and released. Stand to your feet with me, if you would. Kim, Shekinah, come join me. Thank